What's up, guys? Mike here, the Detroit Borg, with the new Galaxy S7 and the S7 Edge. Both phones are all new this year with an improved glass and metal design. The hardware has been upgraded with new processors, waterproofing, bigger batteries, the return of an SD card slot, and all the other goodies launched with the Note 5, like faster fingerprint sensors and fast wireless charging. The Edge, with its curved display, is still $100 more expensive, but now gets a larger display and battery to further separate it from the standard GS7, making the price premium a little more justifiable this time. Getting to the unboxing, Samsung has really upgraded its packaging design for the GS7. The color and capacity are indicated around the edge of the box, and on the back we'll find all of our specs in text color matched to the phone's color. Starting with the GS7 Edge, we just need to cut two tabs along the side. Popping open the lid, we'll find a box lined in sort of a metallic blue color. It's really impressive when you open it up. It's a nice compliment to the stunning silver titanium finish of the GS7 Edge I have here. Now, before I unwrap the phone, let's get to the accessories, which have a few surprises this time. Now, removing the tray, we'll find a larger packet with the SIM ejector peeking through the box. Inside the box, we get a card with that uniquely designed SIM ejector that can be attached to your keychain so you can keep it around. We also get plenty of paperwork, some of which is carrier-specific, such as the Quick Start Guide. All of the accessories are neatly packaged below, including a tinted carrying case for the headphones. These Samsung headphones debuted last year and include an inline remote control and microphone, in addition to replacement ear tips. We also get a Samsung adaptive fast charger with support for Quick Charge 2.0, along with a micro USB charging cable. New this year is a USB adapter, which can be used to transfer your content from your existing iPhone, Android phone, or BlackBerry, and there is software in the setup process that will assist you with this. The standard GS7 unboxing is identical, with the same accessories just scaled to size. Now, getting back to the phones, we just need to peel off these very thin sheets of plastic covering the front and back. Both phones are made of Corning Gorilla Glass 4 on both the front and back. So we do have upgraded next generation glass covering these phones, which is thinner but more durable, which allowed Samsung to make these designs even more seamless. Next up, I just need to boot up the phones and get them set up. Now, both phones have Quad HD Super AMOLED displays, which are brighter and more vivid than ever, with stunning colors and solid blacks. Now, the GS7 is once again 5.1 inches, but the Edge jumps to 5.5 inches. Although the designs look very similar to the GS6, they have been spruced up with more rounded edges and a seamless design, which makes the phones feel much nicer in the hand to hold. The GS7 has rounded edges on the back similar to the Note 5, which makes the phone feel slimmer. The Edge also rounds off the corners on the back of the phone to create a more comfortable grip, while the smoother edges don't feel as sharp and narrow as the previous S6. The continuous and seamless surfacing also eliminates the chamfered edges from the previous phones. As before, the GS7 Edge does feature some degree of palm rejection when gripping the sides of the phone, which is important to avoid unintentional operation. The Edge display is a stunning design feature that adds to the immersive experience of handling this phone. It almost feels as if the display is floating above the glass. The curve is so subtle that distortion is minimal. However, there can be some color shifting due to the curved optics of the glass, which is mostly noticeable on brighter scenes. Down below, we'll find our faster fingerprint scanner picked up from the Note 5, flanked on either side by backlit capacitive Android keys. Up top, we have a waterproof earpiece along with our light sensor, LED notification light, and a 5-megapixel front-facing camera which can record video up to Quad HD resolution. On the back, we'll find an all-new camera system with a huge f1.7 aperture and a new 12-megapixel sensor with larger pixels for improved low-light sensitivity over the previous 60-megapixel camera. The sensor is composed of dual pixels, which allows the camera to find focus more quickly and accurately. The new camera system also has a much lower profile and doesn't stick out as far as the GS6, which is a welcome design improvement. Returning once again is a heart rate monitor and a blood oxygen sensor right next to the camera, which is right below the single LED flash. On the bottom edge, we still have a micro USB port instead of a Type-C port like we see with a lot of new phones, but this time it has waterproofing without the need for a flap. The same is true of the headphone jack, microphone, and single loudspeaker. The speakers sound identical on both phones, but are a little quieter than the previous generation. The speakers are less prone to distortion and are water resistant, but this remains an area that could use some improvement. At the top edge, we have another microphone, in addition to a combination nano SIM and micro SD card tray. The tray does incorporate a gasket to keep water out. Missing is the infrared emitter from the GS6, a feature slowly disappearing from many Samsung phones. On the right side, we have the power button, which is slightly slimmer on the edge, which is also true of the volume controls on the left side. The buttons are responsive and tactile, but because the edge is so slim, it can be easy to unintentionally press them. In terms of battery life, the S7 has a 3000 mAh battery, while the Edge bumps it up to 3600, both huge jumps from the 2600 mAh battery from the previous phones. Both phones support Quick Charge 2.0 and fast wireless charging with support for wireless Qi and PowerMat. In terms of battery life, the S7 Edge achieves a staggering 8 hours of on-screen time at maximum brightness, a full 2 hours more than the S6 Edge in the same test. The GS7 achieved over 6 hours in the same test, a little over an hour better than the GS6 despite a noticeably brighter display. Incidentally, when the phone is turned off and charging, you get a slightly different charging animation for fast charging versus slower charging or standard charging. So that works both with the fast wireless charger or the fast wired charger. Water resistance also returns with the new Galaxy S7, which we lost with the Galaxy S6, but this time we have no flaps covering the ports. So this is IP68 certified, meaning you can submerge this in up to a meter and a half of water for up to 30 minutes. Now, because we have an exposed USB port, the port is smart enough to know whether it's wet or not, so it will prevent the phone from charging if it is wet. Powering the GS7 is a Snapdragon 820, which employs a unique liquid cooling system to keep the 64-bit chip running at optimal performance. The new Adreno 530 GPU improves gaming performance by over 60% and can utilize the new Vulkan API, which further improves gaming performance over OpenGL. Benchmarks reveal this to be one of the most powerful Android phones today, with a single-core score at around 2300 and a multi-core score at around 5300 for both phones. This is a significant improvement over the previous generation, but can't quite beat the single-core score of the iPhone's A9 chip. The GS7 also jumps up to 4 gigs of RAM with 32 or 64 gigs of onboard storage available with expandable memory. In terms of RAM management, we have a lot more RAM to work with, and the GS7 seems to be able to preserve the state of apps better depending on the demands of the system. I was able to keep about 6 to 7 apps, if not more, suspended without relaunching, and performance overall has been very stable. In terms of the camera's quality, this is one of the best cameras I've tested on a smartphone to date. It's quick to launch, quick to focus, and quick to snap a photograph. It's always ready to go and produces outstanding images in a variety of lighting conditions. Images find focus accurately with crisp detail and balanced exposure, so the camera doesn't wash out highlights or underexposed shadows. With such a wide aperture, the camera really does produce some of the most professional photos I've seen in a smartphone without obvious overprocessing or softening. The camera does have a very shallow depth of field, which creates beautiful images, but also means you have to spend more time monitoring your focus points. Make sure you're focusing on what you want. Low light is where the camera really stands out with excellent detail and exposure while preserving color and saturation, which is where most smartphone cameras struggle. Now, if you compare the GS7's low light image next to the iPhone 6S Plus, you can see a similar amount of detail and light sensitivity, but the GS7 is far less cold and washed out. This becomes particularly dramatic when you use the flash on the GS7, which combines with the image processing to produce images that look like they were taken with a full-size camera flash. The difference is especially dramatic when you compare it to the iPhone 6S Plus, which looks dimmer and washed out. Video quality is also outstanding on this phone with optical image stabilization and high bitrate 4K video recording, so you're able to achieve some of the best looking 4K video you can get on a smartphone today. We do have continuous autofocusing on this camera, and it's really smooth and unobtrusive, so you don't have the hunting around like you typically see with these large aperture lenses. So that makes handheld 4K video on this phone really outstanding.
What's up, guys? Mike here, the Detroit Borg, testing out the front-facing camera of the new Galaxy S7, which now has a wider aperture. It's f1.7 instead of 1.9 like last year, but it's still 5 megapixels and can still record in quad HD resolution. As you can see, exposure compensation is very smooth and it's able to keep my face illuminated even in challenging backlit conditions. So, a fantastic camera overall with excellent clarity.
Another new feature with the Galaxy S7 is this always-on display. So this appears when the device is locked, and because we're using Super AMOLED technology, it's only lighting the pixels it needs in order to display this information. So it's very battery efficient. Now, this will always stay on until it's in your pocket or face down, so it's smart enough to know when it doesn't need to be on. And it does move around so it doesn't burn into the display. So there are several ways you can display information here. I'm going to go to Settings, go to Display, and go to Always-on Display, which you can turn off. So if you don't want this on, you can turn that off, or you can also go to your quick settings up here to quickly turn that off. So in terms of content to show, we have three options. We have clock, calendar, or image. So let's take a look at clock. We have several clock styles to pick from, including analog clocks, digital clocks, as well as a dual clock. And then we can select a background image for that clock. So if you want a matching background color here, like blue for this clock, you can choose that. Of course, you have purple, green, and a red color. Or you can choose none at all. We can also choose image, and we have three images, which are battery efficient, so they're designed not to drain too much battery here. So we have like a star field or a row of trees. So if I go and select one of these and go to the lock screen, again, you can see the entire screen is filled up with a star field, which is kind of neat with this AMOLED display, especially in the dark, and it does shift so it doesn't burn in. The Edge Screen software has been updated and upgraded for the Galaxy S7. Once again, the Edge is the only one that gets this, not the standard GS7. But again, this is a feature that you can invoke by swiping in from the edge of the display. Now, you'll find this little tab along the edge, which you can configure, but this is where you swipe in order to invoke the feature. So, for example, on People Edge, I can select the dog groomer here, and this allows me to quickly call them or send them a message. I can also tap and hold on these and reposition them or remove them. We also get Apps Edge. You're limited to 10 apps here, so you can configure this to whatever you want. So for example, if I want to add Chrome to this Apps Edge, I can. Or if I want to remove the standard internet browser, I can do that and add something else. So for example, if I want to add the email, if I want to reposition them, I can, so they'll reorder them. So there we go. We have 10 apps we can quickly jump through just by swiping in from the edge of the screen. Task Edge is a little different here. These are shortcuts to actions, not just apps. So you can modify these by adding to them. So here we have a variety of ones that have already been added, such as calendaring, camera. So if you want to take a picture, take a selfie, or a panorama, you can quickly add those. Alarm clocks, contacts, search contacts, compose emails, and more. So for example, I can launch right into the selfie camera to take a selfie. We also have our options, and this allows us to turn off some of these panels. So we can add new ones or just unselect them. So you can see the ones I've added have been checked in blue. We have others here like stocks, sports scores, Milk Music, or the CNN News app, and a few others, including Compass and your geolocation. So if you want to enable these, you just go ahead and select them. And if you want to know what they are, just tap on them, and that will explain exactly what they are. You can also edit these, so if you want to add your favorite stocks to this widget, you can do so. If you want, you can completely turn off the Edge Screen features, or you can download new panels. And there's not a whole lot here, but they're all free. We have some settings down here, so we can change the positioning of the tab along the side. So you can go to toward the bottom or toward the top or toward the middle, and you can switch it to the left hand or right hand side. We can also change the size here from small to large. I'm just going to leave it at medium, and you can change the transparency. Now this phone is powered by Android 6.0.1, so you can see that on the lock screen with quick access to our phone dialer or the camera app, as well as our notifications up here. Now you can also quickly launch into the camera app just by double tapping the home key. We're familiar with that from previous Samsung devices, and the camera is very fast to launch, and this works no matter where you are in the system, whether you're on the home screen like so, or if the device is locked. Now you can modify the apps that appear on the lock screen. We'll have to go to our settings panel to get to it, so let's go right to our lock screen settings, so lock screen and security, and go to info and app shortcuts. Go to app shortcuts, and we have our left and right shortcuts. So you can turn that off if you don't want the shortcuts at all, or you can pick any app you want. So for example, if you want Chrome, you can select Chrome, and if you want, let's say, the email app, you can go select it for the right side. Now getting to the main home screen, it is fairly classic Samsung TouchWiz, but it has been enhanced once again with a really slick looking interface. It's more simplified, I think it looks a lot better, and performance is very smooth. So you can see we have one feature here that we're pretty familiar with, which is Flipboard Briefing. This allows us to customize our news feed when we swipe to the right. So you can swipe through your articles here, and you can see it's organized by types of news here, and you can also go up to settings to modify this. So you can turn off notifications from this panel if you want. You can also turn off certain categories. You can rearrange them by dragging them around. You can go to more to select specific areas you're interested in. But of course, if you don't want this at all, just pinch in on the home screen. You can see right here, we have the option to turn that off. And there we have our editor as well, which allows us to select our home screen. So if we want a different home screen from default, you can do that. And you can also add new home screens or take them up to delete. We can also change the screen grid. So we can go from 4x4 by default or 4x5 or 5x5 if you want to fit more icons onto your home screens. We also have our themes. So we have quite a few themes to pick from. You can download, many of them are free. So for example, let's go ahead and select this one. We're going to download it. Once it's installed, we can go ahead and apply it. And there we go, everything has been updated for this theme, right down to the drop-down notification shade, the iconography, the colors, and if you want to switch back, just pinch in and out again, go to themes, and switch back to default. We also have our widgets panel, so we can drag and drop our widgets. We're all pretty familiar with this, so if you want our Hangouts widget, we can go ahead and drag it to the screen, or we can go ahead and remove that. Samsung has also updated the way we manage our apps on the home screen. If we tap and hold here, we can take it up to remove it from the home screen, but we now have the option to move the app. So this allows us to move this app to another page here, so we can swipe between our pages and then drag and drop it. We also have our wallpapers, and we do have a motion effect which you can turn on and off. So if you tilt the screen, this will actually show you some movement in terms of the wallpaper in relation to the icons on top of it. And you can also see all the available wallpapers which have been updated for the cleaner look of the Galaxy S7. Taking a look at the app drawer, it's fairly tidy here. We just have one page and we have three folders of items. In my case, I have a T-Mobile folder because this is a T-Mobile phone, but you can see we have a Google folder full of our Google apps, including Android Pay, and we can actually modify this so we can change the color of the folder if we want or just leave it by default. But if you change the folder color, it also changes the icon color. Of course, you can search for apps you want. So if you just want to search for Android, it comes up with Android Pay. We can also quickly alphabetize our apps here by clicking Save. We also have our editor. This allows us to folder our apps within the app drawer so we can create new folders, rearrange them, that sort of thing. Otherwise, if you drag and drop apps in the app folder, it just takes it to the home screen. Now, certain apps have these icons indicating that they can be uninstalled. So you can uninstall this app if you want. But unfortunately, you can see lots of apps cannot be hidden or uninstalled. Now, in terms of Samsung apps, not a whole lot here. We have some standard apps like a file manager. So this allows us to see our file tree directly on the device and everything is organized either by category or you can navigate through device storage. We also have S Voice, which has been enhanced once again, and we have S Health for monitoring our fitness data, as well as Samsung's Milk Music service for streaming music subscriptions. Now, if you take a look at S Voice here, what's the weather like tomorrow in Rochester Hills?
Saturday, you'll see some snow flurries.
The voice has been tweaked a little bit, still doesn't sound great here, but it sounds a little more natural, and you get this little pop-up here instead of filling up the entire screen. Of course, if you want to know what other commands S-Voice can do, there's a list here that you can quickly toggle on. S-Voice is also trained to your voice, so when you first activate S-Voice, it will prompt you to train it. Hi, Galaxy. What's the weather like tomorrow in Toronto?
Saturday looks like it will be a cloudy day with a high of 33.
This will also work when the device is locked. Hi, Galaxy. What's the weather like tomorrow in Chicago?
Saturday, don't forget your snow boots.
We also have Game Launcher, which is an ecosystem for Samsung devices for games. So you can load all your games in here, keep track of the scores, and see top charts, featured videos. But we can also get to game tools, which is kind of interesting. This also allows us to manage our power usage while playing games. Game Tools is a useful widget that appears over your gameplay and tucks away when you don't need it. You can reposition this as well, so if you want it on the left-hand or right-hand side, you can do that. So this brings up some useful tools like recording your gameplay. You can take a screenshot. You can minimize gameplay. So this will suspend the game. Pop it out in this little pop-out so you can continue doing something else in the background and bring it back forward when you want to. So resuming the game here, I can actually lock the recents and back key so I don't accidentally trigger those, and I can also mute my notifications. Now this is Android 6.0, so if you tap and hold the home key, this will launch into Google Now on Tap, which will scan the screen for search items and link you to them. Of course, you can also just jump right to Google Now if you want. Samsung has tweaked the recent apps here just a bit here, so you can see the animation is slightly different. We have a close all button down here, and we have split screen view, which we can activate from this viewer. So you can see certain apps are available for split screen view with these little indicators by the close icon. So that tells me I can open them up side by side. So I can open up YouTube, and then I can pick another app to open up, including Chrome. So I can watch a YouTube video and browse the web at the same time.
My name is Aaron Gilbert, Dr.
So I can resize the window to whatever size I want. If I tap on the icon, I can switch between the top and bottom view if I want. And then as you can see, when I tap on the screen, it's highlighted in blue, indicating that that app is active. So if I want to go back within that app, I just have to select it and then hit the back button. You can also activate split screen view by tapping and holding the recent apps icon. And so again, if I want to launch into Chrome or launch into YouTube, just tap and hold on that until you get to your selector. Now, if I tap the circle, I get to options like maximize this window window, close it out, copy items from this window to paste it into the next, or I can minimize the window, which gives me this little floating bed, which allows me to navigate around the interface without interference. And if I want to bring it forward, just tap on it again and I get this little window view. That window can be resized to whatever you want, or you can go ahead and maximize it, close it out, that sort of thing. Also, if you have these window views open, if you press the home button, they will minimize into these little badge views, and then we can go somewhere else. We can also activate the pop-up viewer by swiping in from the upper left or right corner. This allows us to create these little windows, and again, you can minimize them by hitting the home button. Now, this means you can have up to 5 windows open at the same time. And again, you can minimize them all by hitting the home button. And then we have these little badges that float around. Now, if you tap and hold on them, you can actually remove them to close them out. Swiping down on our notification panel, you can see things have been updated quite a bit here. No longer green accents, instead we have blue, grays, and whites, and it's a much brighter looking experience. Of course, down below, we have all of our notifications with a clear all button, and you can go to the notification settings so you can manage them directly from here. So you can turn off notifications from certain apps if you want, and you can go to advanced for more detailed information. So under advanced, we can set specific permissions for apps. So we can see allow notifications, set as a priority, preview and pop-ups, and more. So among the features here includes quick connect. This allows us to see devices on our network that we could connect to wirelessly, such as a smart TV, a printer, or that sort of thing. So like all quick settings, we can tap and hold on one of them in order to jump right to the settings panel for that option. Of course, we have lots of controls like vibrate, mute, and sound. We can turn off our GPS location, auto rotate the screen, turn on Bluetooth or turn it off, and then we have Wi-Fi calling. This is a T-Mobile device, so we do have Wi-Fi calling available. You can turn that off if you want. We have some power saving modes, so we can turn that on and that will dim the display. If you want to know more about what it does, just tap and hold and it takes you right to it. We also have Do Not Disturb, and we can manage this. Just tap and hold on it, and this will take you to your control panel. So you can turn this on right now, or you can schedule it, and this is where you can set specific times or days in which this turns on. We can also allow exceptions. So we have no exceptions, mute all calls and alerts, alarms only, or you can customize it. So if somebody calls us twice, that will allow that caller to come through. We can also allow certain calls from contacts or your favorites. We can also receive messages from certain contacts, favorites, or none at all. You can also enable event tasks and alerts, so if you want to receive your notifications for calendar events, you can add that, and then you can turn on your reminders as well. Swiping down again, we get to some additional options. So we have Ultra Power Saving Mode, a feature we're familiar with. This is sort of a limp home mode. This allows you to preserve battery life for critical functions only, such as phone dialer, messaging, internet browsing, that sort of thing. It also reduces the screen's brightness and reduces it to grayscale to, again, maximize battery life. So again, we have our phone dialer, messaging, internet browsing. You can add certain apps here, so you're limited to Facebook, email, clock, calculator, and memo. And down here, we'll find our battery life and estimated time remaining. Next up, we have private mode, a feature we're familiar with from previous Samsung devices. This basically hides certain files behind a password or a fingerprint scan. So this allows us to hide certain images or files. This only works within certain apps like the Gallery app. So if I go to the Gallery app here and I want to hide one of these images, I can go in and select it. I can go to More. And then under More, I can move that item to private. So that is now only available when I've turned on private mode, which is protected with a password. So if I go to my drop-down shade now, and I go ahead and turn off private mode, that image disappears. In order for me to regain access to it, I'll have to turn on private mode again, which again is behind the password or fingerprint. So the image should reappear here. If I go back to my gallery, you'll see it's back here. And you'll see it's actually highlighted with that little icon. We also have Smart View. This is a Samsung feature. This allows you to stream or push content from your smartphone to a compatible Samsung Smart TV. We can also quickly toggle off Always On Display from this dropdown, and we have S Finder, which allows us to quickly search our entire device. So for example, if you want to search for display settings, just type it in. It takes you right to the display settings. Of course, you can also bring up contacts or apps, and that sort of thing. Now, of course, you can rearrange these. Let's go up to Edit. And you can see we have our first row here, and then we have the extended row down here. Now, if I want to move this to the first row, I can go ahead and do so. So I can keep S Finder quickly up there, as well as the Always On Display. And I can rearrange them if I want. So for features I don't anticipate using very much, like Ultra Power Saving Mode, I can go ahead and drag them out. But you can see it rearranges them and keeps that row full no matter what. You can also turn off the Quick Connect feature from the drop-down shade if you don't want it. Now, checking out the settings panel, right now I'm on the GS7, so I have edge screen settings. That's the only feature the GS7 Edge has that the GS7 doesn't have. So we have this continuous list view, which is broken down into certain categories, and up top, we have quick shortcuts, which you can edit. So this allows us to select up to 9. Right now, they've given us 6 by default, but we can go ahead and add others. So if you go ahead and add 3 more here, if we go back, you can see it's rearranged to 3 rows. So under Wi-Fi, we'll find a feature here that's kind of useful to know about because it's off by default, and that is Smart Network Switch. So if you enable this, this will actually allow the device to search for a stronger network. So for example, if you're on a Wi-Fi network and it becomes unstable, it will automatically switch to the cellular network. Under NFC and payment, this is where we can select our default tap and pay systems. So if we go to tap and pay, you can see we have Samsung Pay or Android Pay. So if you want to use Samsung Pay, you can go and select it. And you can also see we have other options, including Google Wallet. Under more connection settings, we have mirror link. This works within cars. So if you have a car that's compatible with this feature, if you turn this on and you connect a USB cable, you can actually mirror the display of your Samsung phone on the car's head unit. We also have Download Booster, which you can turn on. It's off by default, but this will combine the speed of your Wi-Fi and LTE network. And this is where you can also manage Wi-Fi calling, Wi-Fi preferred, cellular network preferred, or never use cellular network for calling. We also have our Smart Manager. This allows us to quickly access and monitor our critical functions like battery life, storage, RAM, and device security. So if you go to battery life, this is basically the battery control panel. So we can see our two power saving modes, battery optimization based on apps, and then we can enable or disable the battery percentage on the status bar. But we can also turn off fast cable charging. So if you don't want fast charging over the USB cable, you can actually turn that off. I don't believe we've seen that before. We also have our storage. Right now, I've used up about 38%, and of course, it will break down in detail what's taking up that space. We also have our RAM usage, so you can see what apps are taking up your RAM right now, and you can end all to clear it. Under sound and vibration, a lot going on here. I don't want to get into too much detail. A lot of them are pretty familiar controls, such as vibration intensity. You can customize the vibration pattern, but what I want to get to is sound quality and effects, which is kind of buried here. So we have different equalizers here. So if we select them, we have normal, pop, classic, jazz, rock, or custom. So if you select it and go back, you can customize your EQ manually. You can also select advanced controls. So you can change your vocal emphasis, instrument emphasis, bass, and treble. And then we also have these grayed out selections. And they're grayed out right now because I don't have headphones connected. These only work when headphones are connected. We also have adapt sound, which is nice. This allows you to calibrate the audio experience to your ears and to your headphones. And this will basically walk you through it. Under display, we'll find some interesting options I don't think I've seen before, including these icon backgrounds. So if you want to unify your icon pack here, so right now you can see these are the Samsung icons and these are the Google icons, and they have their own shape. So if you want to add this background, this will actually unify it. So all I have to do is click done here. If I go to the home screen now, you can see everything has a matching background, so it really unifies the overall aesthetic experience. I actually really like it. We have Smart Stay, a familiar feature we've seen for a long time from Samsung phones. It's off by default, but again, this will use the camera to monitor for the presence of your eyes to prevent the display from going to sleep if you're looking at it, and vice versa. Night Clock. So Night Clock is a feature available only on the Edge screen. So let's go ahead and click that on. So you can turn this on at specific times of day. Obviously, I want to kick it in right now so we can take a look at it. So I'm going to click on, and then you can change the side, whether you want it on the left-hand or right-hand side. So when this feature turns on, you'll have a very dimly lit clock along the left-hand or right-hand edge. It also displays the current date and time and battery status. And if you rub along that edge, it'll wake it up and display your current notifications. And if you swipe along that edge, you can actually see a news ticker as well. We also have our screen modes, which includes adaptive display, AMOLED cinema, AMOLED photo, and basic, and this will preview exactly how that looks. You can also tell it to keep the display turned off. So if the display wakes up in a dark location like your pocket, this will prevent it from waking up. So for example, if you accidentally trigger the camera or wake up the display by hitting the home button or lock button, this will prevent it from staying on. We also have easy mode, which I often call grandma mode. This simplifies the interface and gives you larger icons. If you click that, click done here. So we have our most important apps on the main home screen, and then you can add additional apps on the right, swipe to the left, and you can add quick contacts. Under backup and reset, this is where we'll find Open Smart Switch. This allows you to transfer your information from one device to this device, and that's where that little adapter comes in handy. So you can transfer from an iOS device, an Android device, or even a BlackBerry device. Under advanced features, we have one-handed operation, which is off by default, but if you enable this and you triple tap the home button, this will give you a one-handed mode, which allows you to switch between the left hand and right hand side, and you can return to full screen if you want. We also have one-handed input, and that works with the keyboard. So, for example, if you bring up the phone dialer, the keyboard is now left justified or right justified. That works for the calculator and the keyboard. You can also disable the quick launch camera. So, again, that's a double press of the home button to launch it. So, if you don't want that, you can turn that off. We also have smart capture. So, we can turn this on. It's a feature that allows us to take a larger screen grab than what's immediately on the screen. So, if I go to a website here that's longer than the screen, obviously, they have a lot here. So, if I want to screen grab this entire thing, I do a screen grab like so. And then I can go ahead and continue adding to that screen grab as it scrolls through. And as you can see along the right edge here, it builds out for you. You can continue adding as much as you want. You can also crop this so you can see the entire screen grab here. So I can crop it and resize it in terms of width or height. We do have some familiar Samsung features like direct call. So if you're looking at a contact, a message, or contact details, just raise your phone to your ear, it automatically dials them. We have smart alerts, so if you have a pending notification and you pick up your phone, it vibrates for you. And then we have easy mute. So if you palm your device, this will mute any notifications, alarms, or calls. Now if you press and hold the power button along the side, you get to an option we've seen before, which is emergency mode, which has been tweaked here. So let's go and turn this on, that will explain exactly what emergency mode. But again, it's sort of like ultra power saving mode. The idea here is to give you tools when you're in an emergency, like a weather emergency or some other emergency you can think of. So you can turn on the flashlight. We have an emergency alarm, which is very loud. You can share your GPS location. You have your phone dialer, internet browser, and again, you have emergency calls. So if you need to call somebody like 911, and you also have your current battery status. So at 98%, it estimates 1.1 days of use. Checking out the camera app, a lot going on here per the usual for Samsung, so we can pinch in and out to zoom with an animation. We do have tracking autofocus in here, tap anywhere to adjust exposure and focus. Of course, we can take a burst shot by tapping and holding on the camera and you get that little countdown. It's really fast. We can also record our video, and while recording video, we can snap photographs even in 4K, pause it and resume it like so. Lots of modes here, so we can go to our settings, which allows us to select our resolution. Right now I'm in ultra high definition, but we have QHD, full HD at 60 frames per second and below that. We also have motion photo, which is a feature you can turn on. This is actually somewhat similar to Apple's live photo on the iPhone 6S and 6S Plus. So if that feature is turned on, every time you snap a photograph, it's actually recording the first few seconds and last few seconds to stitch together a short video. But when you go to your gallery, all you see is an image until you play it. So there you go, you get audio and video as well. Also under settings, we have tracking autofocus. You can turn that off. You can turn on the grid lines, location tags, shooting methods. So we have rear. So if you want to use voice control, you can do that. So smile, cheese, capture, shoot, and more. So if we go back to the camera here, shoot. Takes a photograph. We can also quickly access our favorite features here, such as our image resolution. So we have 4x3 at 12 megapixels. And if you want 16x9, it's cropped to 9.1 megapixels. As always, we have a ton of modes to pick from. So if you want to know what all of these modes are, just go up to info and you'll get a description for each one of them. We can also download new ones. So if you want to install modes you don't see here, some of them used to be included with previous Samsung devices. You can get them back here. So you can see free, all, new, or paid, and there are none paid right now. But taking a look at the modes that we do have, you can rearrange these if you want. So if you want to change the order, you can do that. And if you download new ones, you can delete them. Now, one of the cool ones is Pro Mode. This gives us full manual control for things like exposure, aperture, ISO, white balance, manual focus, as well as these little filters here, which you can select from. We also have live broadcast, a feature we've seen before on the Note 5 and Galaxy S6 Edge Plus, which allows us to broadcast live to YouTube. We also have video collage. This allows us to stitch together a 6-second clip out of 6 separate shots, which is kind of neat. Of course, we also have a front-facing camera with lots of features here, including a flash that's somewhat similar to the Retina flash on iPhone 6S. So it flashes the screen to a color-matched tone, which reads the ambient light conditions for the right tone. Of course, we have lots of settings here for our resolution, this camera cord, and QHD video resolution as well, which is the native resolution of the display. We have our effects here we can pick from, and then we have things like Beauty Face, which actually detects for the presence of your face and softens the details to be more flattering. We can also flash our hand to the camera, and then we'll begin a countdown. So in the end, the Galaxy S7 really are outstanding phones with fantastic displays, cameras, battery life, processing power, and a software experience which looks a lot better than previous generations and is really smooth and kind of complements the design of the phone as well as the displays. Now in my case, I really like the look and the features it adds, so I really have no issues with TouchWiz, especially since performance is so much better this time. As for which phone I would prefer, I would definitely prefer the GS7 Edge for its larger display and battery life, which makes a huge impact. But if you're a fan of a smaller phone, you may want the GS7 at 5.1 inches. I think this is the more conventional size, and both phones look fantastic, made of nice materials, which feel great in the hand to handle, and they really stand out as something really premium. All right, guys, so that's going to do for me in this video. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again in the next video.